morning. Welcome to our morning worship service. Let me invite you to come on in to God's house. It's so good to see each and every one of you. Today is a very special day for our church family and for Brother Caleb, Mrs. Hannah, and his parents. And as we have an ordination service in a unique way, and I'm excited about this opportunity we have as a church to be a part of this, ordaining a young man into the ministry. And so thankful for his love and his desire to fulfill God's call on his life. The Bible says in Psalm 100, a familiar passage of scripture, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good." Amen. Amen. The rest of you that are talking and getting your mind geared up for worship, the Lord is good. Amen. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth. Aren't you thankful to all generations? Let's stand together. Let's get some of that joy of the Lord. It's in our heart, up on our face. Let's sing this little chorus. "I'm so glad Jesus lifted me." It has three verses. Let's sing it out together as we begin worshiping him in this hour. Seated. Good singing this morning. Again, we welcome you into our worship hour. We enjoyed a good hour of teaching and instruction in our Sunday school ministry, and I'm so very thankful for that and thankful for this opportunity. Thankful to see you. And again, this special service, ordination service, that we get to come together as a church family and participate in. Such a blessing. Would you help me pray that God will be honored and glorified, and His name will be magnified in everything that is said and done here today, and that He'll be pleased as we seek to honor Him, not only with our life, but with this very service. And so let's ask Him to meet with us in a special way. Brother James Price, could I ask you to stand and lead us in this opening prayer, please?
Nothing is too hard. I am the shepherd and I am the door. I am the good news to the bound and the poor. I am the ultimate sacrifice.
a tough one to get through without just wanting to throw your hands up and praise Him. Aren't you thankful He is the great I Am? The great I Am. And all the attributes and characteristics you just heard the choir sing about are so true and so comforting. But I'm thankful He also says, I am the one that sticketh closer than the brother. Aren't you thankful we have a friend, and His name is Jesus? And He's never going to leave us. He's never going to forsake us. He's never going to abandon us and leave us to figure it out on His own. He's always there for us in the time of need. Would you stand with me once more and sing this great hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. If you want your hymnal, it's hymn 589. Before we receive our offering this morning, let's lift our voices in this great hymn and praise Him for the I Am that He is. Lift up their voices in song, praising our Savior all the day long. And my heart has already been blessed. And we're going to continue worshiping the Lord with our tithes and offerings. This is our opportunity to give back to the Lord as He has so abundantly blessed each and every one of us. And I trust you're faithful to do so. I trust you can do with a joyful heart as the Lord commands us to do in Scripture. And I trust you've learned that you can live a lot better on what you keep after you give to the Lord than you can trying to keep it all. And He'll bless you for your faithfulness. So let's give to Him now. And in this time of offering, we'll start with sections 1 and 3. If you have an offering to bring forward, you can do so after the prayer, and then sections 2 and 4 to follow as our choir comes down. Brother Carroll, would you lead us, please? Thankful He gave His lifeblood. Amen. Wonderful reminder there. Thank you, musicians. Always do such a wonderful job.
what they feel. They testify to a faith that's settled and it's real.
Aren't you thankful he's always good? Even when life doesn't go like we think or wish it would, sometimes we think should, God is still good. Amen. We're going to dismiss our junior and children's church. And the kids, you go quickly because you'll be rejoining us at the end of the service for the special time of ordination. And so we invite you to do that. And Brother Caleb and Miss Hannah, I know y'all have already got comfortable, and I know your parents came all the way down from Michigan just to sit beside you during the service. But for this morning, I'm going to ask you to move up here on the second row right in front of your teens, the two of you, please. And it is a unique opportunity as we're making these transitions for us as a church to be a part of this ordination service for Brother Caleb and Mrs. Hannah, and it's so good to have his parents here. And we will let them sit with y'all tonight, all right? So y'all save them a seat tonight, and we'll put them back there. But the Word of God is first and foremost and premier this morning, but we want you right here because as a church, we are ordaining you into the gospel ministry that God has called you. You understand? A man can't call, a pastor can't call, a church can't call, but God has placed his hand on this young man's life, and we'll share a little more about that towards the conclusion. This is a very unique situation we have. If you want to be taking your Bibles and going to 2 Timothy chapter 4 will be our text, and we have jumped into the preaching this morning a little earlier so that we can have some time at the conclusion of the service. And this would normally be done in a PM service, but due to the nature of our situation this month and things we have going on and just putting all the pieces together, we have been afforded the opportunity to do it during the AM service, which is very unique, I think very special. And so the message is for all of us, okay? So don't check out and think that it's not for you. It's actually very neat and interesting to me. My heart has been burdened about some things, and the pastor carries some messages on his heart, and sometimes I think, well, that'd be for a Sunday night or Wednesday night. But then, and I'm not picking, I'm just the reality of our mindset sometimes. But then we're like, well, no, the crowd's not as good as on Sunday night and Wednesday night. It needs to be a Sunday morning, but you can't fit it in. And so God has uniquely brought this opportunity, ordination, together, certainly with some reminders from this text that I think is good for us. It's been good for me as a preacher to dive back into, But I think it's good for you as a congregation, whether you've been saved for 50 plus years or just 5 weeks, to understand the importance of the call upon a man's life that stands in front of you each week behind this desk to preach the Word of God. And so I trust all of you will be open and receiving to receptive to the message. And then we'll conclude and let the Holy Spirit do what He wants to do. And then we will direct a specific charge to Brother Caleb and certainly have some presentations and for him. So that's how we will conclude the message. But all of us can benefit from this passage. And so I've heard the pages turning, cease to turn. I'm so thankful you bring your Bibles and have them with you. Let's all stand if you're physically able. The 2 Timothy chapter 4 will be our text. And what we'll do is there in the message part, Lord willing, now he can guide me and change and move me around any way he wants to do. But as the Holy Spirit gives liberty, we're going to preach the first part of this passage to all of us and then saving the last few elements specifically as a charge. The first part's more familiar to all of us, although it does apply to you, Brother Caleb. And then the last part we'll include in on the charge. But let's begin 2 Timothy chapter 4. If you found it and you're with me, would you say a hearty amen? Amen. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come, and they will not endure sound doctrine. But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of evangelists. Make full proof of thy ministry. Familiar passage of Scripture to all of us, but certainly as we come to such a special and solemn time of ordaining and having a part as a church body, ordaining a young man to the ministry. Your most familiar verses there are found in verse 2 and 3, and I want us to read those one more time before we pray. It says, the first imperative, which is a command for us in verse 2, is to what? Preach the word. That is our high calling. That is our supreme calling, to preach the word. And then we're given further information about preaching the word to be instant in season and out of season. And then we have this list of things given that sometimes people don't like, but it's important, it's in the Bible, and you kind of got to accept it whether you like it or not. But understand, all of these next imperatives come after the imperative to preach the word. Paul then tells young Timothy, as you preach the word and you're in season, or you preach it in season and out of season, you also reprove, you rebuke, and you exhort. And that is a high challenge for any man of God from the one who has called us, commissioned us. You may be seated. Thank you for kindly standing to honor the reading of God's word. You see their title there, the high calling and charge to the minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, would you use this special service, this text, this vessel? Well, that's all I am. Honored to have a part in this service for Brother Caleb as we ordain him into the gospel ministry. But yet, Lord, convicted and challenged in my own spirit to strive daily to be the man of God that you called me to be, that Paul charges Timothy to be. Lord, it's not easy. It's not always fun. It's painful. Comes with burdens. But yet, Lord, there's no higher calling on earth. For a humble servant, wretched sinner, to be called to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Do a special work that is sealed up in the mind and heart of Brother Caleb until you take him home in this service today. But also do a work in the minds and hearts of our people. Whether they've been in church longer than I've been alive, or they're new to church and a church trying to live by biblical standards and not man's preferences. Teach us, help us, challenge us this, we pray. It is in your Son's precious name we ask these things. Amen. Amen. As I already mentioned, Paul is writing to young Timothy. Timothy was a young man that Paul had kind of taken under his wings and became his spiritual father. He's also a young a man that Paul, in earlier passages of Scripture, had laid hands, as we will do later, on Brother Caleb, not in a physical, harmful way, but had laid hands on him, ordaining Timothy to preach the gospel. And so Paul knows this is very important, and in the last season of Paul's life, when he knows his time is short, that's what you find in the verses after the text that we read. Paul knows that his time is short. He knows he'll be leaving this world soon. He wants to give and communicate with good and clear understanding to young Timothy what an awesome responsibility he has to be under the call of God to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so he gives some very specifics here. And I want you as a church family to do two things. I want you to receive these in your own heart as, hey, this means that an under-shepherd is, this is the relationship he has with us as the sheep, first of all. Second of all, I want you to begin and reminding yourself and understanding that this is the call that any man going into the ministry is called and commissioned to do by the one who called us. So it's not something you get to pick and choose, Brother Caleb. It's not something you get to look at the sweet moments and take them and avoid the difficulties. It's not the good conversations you get to have while admitting the bad ones or the tough ones. It's all in here for all of us and for a young man that's ordained. An outline similar to this probably has been preached hundreds and hundreds of times, because in this setting, when applied to an ordination service, I just believe that it is so appropriate, but yet so fresh for us this morning. Would you notice, first of all, with me, we see here in the text the preacher and the mandate that he has upon his life. The preacher and his mandate. We see there in the opening word, the second word of our text, was that word charge. I charge you, Timothy. Charge there in the original language presents itself in the present tense. And so that helps us, because it informs us that he is being called to a continuous, solemn charge. This is not a charge, Brother Caleb, that we give you here in just a few moments that you tuck away, you hang something on the wall, you put it in your briefcase, and then you alleviate yourself from it. This is a continuous charge. That's the verbiage that is giving here, a daily continual, but it's also a very solemn charge, a very serious charge. It's not something that, as a young minister, is to be taken with flippancy. It's not something, as a congregation, you'd be sitting there saying, oh boy, we're preaching to Brother Caleb. This is a church. We come together today to ordain a man into the ministry. It's a solemn, it's a serious ordeal. And for young Timothy, Paul wanted this to be ringing in his ears, Brother Caleb. Every time he gets up to minister, every time he opens his Bible and his study helps to prepare the Word of God for the flock of God, he is to remember, hey, I am charged by God Almighty in this that I'm called to do. Serious, solemn. The verb that is used there actually in their context had legal connections, which means it meant to testify under oath in a court of law. That's the seriousness and the fortitude that was behind this. So we kind of get the picture of the Apostle Paul here calling his young disciple Timothy in front of God's judicial bench, calling him up in front of all those and charging him under oath with the awesome responsibility and task for Caleb to preach this book. Not your thoughts, not your opinions, not what's popular, but to preach thus saith the Lord. That's the picture we have before us. Now, get a hold of this next phrase. I charge thee therefore. You ready? You got your seatbelt on? Before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. A charge that is being given to a young man going into the ministry is before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Paul uses that phrase to remind Timothy, my gracious, get a hold of this, that God and the Lord Jesus Christ is observing the ministry of a preacher. On good days, we can't walk up here without any pressure on us. What a humbling reality. Making even my legs to shake to realize that what we do is before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. And their society, an oath that was sworn by a deity. In other words, with these words attached, by God and the Lord Jesus Christ, considered especially to be binding and very dangerous to break. We as a church have a role in this ordination, but we as a church did not call Brother Caleb Griffey to preach. God did. And that is a very serious and binding calling and commitment in your life that was very dangerous to break. Why does he remind young Timothy of this? He reminds young Timothy that as he ministers, it will not always be easy. As he ministers, people will not always like him. As he ministers, people will not always pat him on the back and say, boy, I needed that message today, preacher, that convicted me of the sin that I was just guilty of this week. Those comments will not always come. Those feelings will not always be there. But Paul tells Timothy, you need to understand that you have an eternal accountability as a preacher of the gospel to God and the Lord Jesus Christ. And just as every one of us will give an account for what we do with the truths of God's word, just as you as lay men and lay women will give an account to the message that is delivered today, we as ministers of God will stand before the Almighty Judge and give an account for how we have under-shepherded the flock that God has entrusted to us. Would you take your Bibles and go with me to a couple passages, please? First of all, to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 reminds us of this great truth in verse 10. It says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Now, I want to keep things moving so we have adequate time as we charge Brother Caleb, but stay within a reasonable time frame this morning. What a sobering thought is found in verse 10. Every one of us standing before God to give an account for the good and the bad of our lives. Would you flip over a little bit more back towards the Old Testament to Romans chapter 14. Romans chapter 14 and verse 12 echoes this same thought. I just want you to see it in Scripture. What we give you here is not our words, our ideas, or thoughts, but it's the Bible. Verse 12 says, so then every one of us shall give account of his neighbor, of his family member, of that church member that they were always pointing at saying, why didn't they do this? Why don't they do this? Why are they not involved? Why are they living like this? No, it says they'll give an account of himself to God. You're not giving an account to this pastor or to anybody in these pews. You will give an account to Almighty God. So for the calling he has placed on your life, and for the ministry you fulfill through the power and help of the Holy Spirit of God. Brother Caleb, you are to preach. Whether it's in the teen center to the teens, whether it's in the gym, whether it's in this auditorium, or somewhere else, you are to preach with this reality and knowledge on your mind at all times, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Do I want to help you every time I open this book and preach and feed you spiritually? Do you know your pastor to know well enough I want to help you? But my number one goal is to please the one who has called me. And if you like it and helps you, great. If you walk out mad and don't shake my hand, so be it. But every one of us will give an account of himself to God. When a servant of God preaches, he cannot afford to be influenced by the reaction of the congregation. You cannot afford to be influenced by opposition of the critics, and unfortunately, they will come from time to time. You're accountable to the Lord alone. The preacher's not accountable to some board for his preaching. The preacher's not accountable to an association. He's not accountable to the people that sit in the pew. No, he is accountable to God. And so furthermore, you're not to water down the message and the gospel of Jesus Christ. You're not to try to make it sound better and sweeter and kinder for the society we live in 2023. You're to preach the word of God straightforward. With love, with compassion, with conviction, just as it's written. Realizing your job is to cut it straight and let it fall where it may. Let's go through a couple words quickly. He says, I charge ye therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead. We've looked at corresponding verses there at his appearing in his kingdom. And here's the imperative, the number one imperative, the highlighted imperative, the top of the shelf imperative, preach. Preach. You know, the word comes as to herald a king's message to the people, to sound the word of the king with a voice that is loud and a voice that is clear. That's what the word literally meant. The message was to be heard, and the message was to be heeded. I don't have time to preach this, but you do understand. You can sit there, you can look at me, you can have your ears on, you can hear the message, but you don't necessarily heed to the message. Guess what? When you walk out of those doors, you give an account to God. Are you not pulling one over on me saying, well, I'm not going to pay attention to preacher day? You are here, you are listening, and you will give an account to God. The message was to be heard and it was to be heeded. Second of all, the messenger was to be respected and unhindered. Now listen, not because of who he was, not because of his name, but because of who he represented. He was to be heard and he was to be unhindered. Because he had a message from God that was greater than anything he could say. He was to preach, to herald. Then it says, to preach the word. I've got all caps in my notes here. The word, not a word. The word of God. There's a difference, my friend. And unfortunately, in today's society, we're hearing the difference. Loud and clear. But it's not from God. We as men of God are to preach the word of God, and it is in vanity if we preach anything else besides the word of God. Wasting our time, wasting our breath, wasting the time of the hearers who come to hear from God. We're to preach the word. Second of all, we're to preach the whole counsel of God. The whole counsel of God. You know what that means? Even in a teen setting. That means there's going to be some times that God has burned a message on your heart. And you fall on your knees and say, God, I really got to preach this Sunday. Lord, is this the word that, I mean, can I preach something sweet? Can I preach something that will get them jumping and hollering? Can I preach something to make them feel, God, is this what I got to preach? The whole counsel of God. How many of you are on a physically, a regular diet of health of some sorts. You're supposed to eat this, you're supposed to not. Let me see your hands. Let's wake up some of you, get some of you tuned back in. Wow, the rest of you are really acting like you're more healthy than I'll just leave it there. But we all know a regular diet of health consists of variety, right? How many of you love red meat and steak? How many of you to the point in life it would not be good to eat that 3, 4, 5 times a week for your health? I mean, it would be good, but it wouldn't produce good results, right? You understand the basic point here is that we're to have a healthy diet when it comes to the physical food we take in. Vegetables are good. Meat's good. Bread's good. Sweet tea sure is good. But water's good. And all these juices. Now, I can't keep up. I just got orange juice and apple juice for my kids. I can't keep up with all the juices y'all drink. They come out with a new juice all the time. I don't know what y'all drinking. But it's for health reasons, right? Wouldn't it be good to have the same thing every time, would it? I'm going somewhere with this. As much as I, with passion, and feel a burden to preach on hell, y'all listening? It wouldn't be the healthiest diet for me to come in here every Sunday morning to believers and preach on hell. Now, I may help one or two of you. No, I'm just kidding. But to believers, you also need a healthy diet. Now, here's what I've learned in 10 years of pastoring. Some people want me to preach on hell every week. And I hate to say it's not so that other people get saved. It's so I don't step on their toes preaching on the rest of the Bible. It'd be a great time to amen right there, church, because you know it's true and your face is showing it, so I might as well just go ahead and admit it to the Holy Ghost. No, I'm just kidding, but it is true sometimes. You're to preach all of it. You're to preach it when they walk up to you and say, if you ever preach on that again, I'm never coming back here again. You're kind, you're loving, you're compassionate, but you preach the truth. The whole counsel of God. To do so, this requires, I'm just going to use my word, intense study. I will say 2 Timothy 2:15, study, first of all, to show thyself approved unto, ready for this word? We miss it all the time. A workman. The preacher's life is to be a lifetime commitment to the study of the Word of God. He'll tell you, we worked on his schedule. We adjust his schedule. We. Why? Because I've told him I want to protect his study time. He's preparing in a different way in this stage of ministry, but I want him to protect that study time. Can I tell you that a church family needs to understand this? And a church family needs to support the man of God as he grows in the Word. I say it laughingly because I don't think it was meant as a, well, it probably was, but I've been lovingly told that maybe I study too much for my preaching. The flip side of the coin is the one they don't see, where I feel convicted for not studying enough. When I stand to preach his words, inspired, infallible, and errant word of God. I would much rather you criticize me of studying too much than to walk into this pulpit flippantly and unprepared for what God has called me to do. It's a call to study. And the preaching, the Word of God has to be a priority. And can I help you with this? I'm just going to let you marinate on this and go because I want to stay on time. If the preaching of the Word of God is a priority. What also concerning the Word of God has to be a priority. Before we can practice it, we've got to hear it. I want you to understand, church, this is why we use the word engage a lot. If you just come and are a pew sitter, you are missing it, my sweet friend. You're missing it. You are to be engaged, and the hearing of God's word, the hearing of the preaching of God's word is to be a priority. That's why we ask for no moving around. That's why we ask for the men in the lobby not to be congregated and talking. It's the preaching of God's word. And anything else that trumps that is a little God in your life taking priority over the preaching of the word of God. I got to hurry. He says, be instant, in season, out of season. The idea here is that there will be times when preaching is easy, seemingly. There will be times when you feel like you walk to the pulpit with 250 pounds on your back. It's not always easy. The phrase there means you preach it when it seems to come natural and flowing, and you preach it when it's difficult. You preach it when the people want to receive it. You preach it when they don't want to receive it. You see, this has often been, unfortunately, misrepresented in context. I even had a gentleman, I'm going to chalk it up as he was joking, but when I was in Chapel Southeastern, wearing navy blue pants and a yellow dress shirt, sitting off to the right side of the chapel the way it was presented then, or set up then, and he looks over and says, Jonathan Angel is going to come up and preach for us. It was not my turn to preach. I wasn't even down to preach. I wasn't even on a list to preach. And he says that, and then he makes a joke. Hey, the Bible says be instant in season and out of season, referring to be ready all the time. But that is actually not what it means in the context. It's much deeper than that. See, we can have something ready to preach all the time, but it means you preach it when they're standing at the door waiting on you. You preach it when it's hard. You preach it when the society is against it. You preach it when nobody wants to hear it. There'll be times when you feel like people are listening. There'll be times you look at the top of people's head more than you do the eyes on their face, where they're unengaged. You preach it. In season, out of season. Regardless of how the wind may blow, regardless of the pressures of a society at any given time, stand forth and preach the word of God. There's no checking the wind. There's no seeing what's popular. We're not called to tickle the ears and make people feel good. We're called. We're commissioned. You're being charged today to speak the truth of God's word. I think another misconception, can I take like a two-minute timeout? I'll take that as a unanimous yes. I think there's a misconception when a preacher does what he's called to do and he preaches hard from the Bible, not his thoughts or opinions, but principles from the Bible. And people get mad and people will form an attitude that a church or a person is legalistic or too strict or too this or too that. A man is charged to preach the whole counsel of God. Agree? Say amen. He doesn't get to a text and say, you know what, that is going to sting some people in 2023. I think, Lord, I'm just going to keep on going. He doesn't get to do that. Not if he's true to his calling. Not if he's a man of God. He preaches it. Don't get mad at the preacher, whether it's this preacher, whether it's some other preacher. If they're telling you the truth of God's word, you deal with that in your spirit with the Holy Spirit of God. You let the Word of God help you. Don't get mad. Don't go falsely label a man of God or a work of God because they preach the truth of God. Have a heart that's ready to receive the Word of God. Whether it makes you feel good or it puts a conviction on you that is, listen, church. I don't preach on things like faithfulness and modesty and not having any other gods in your life because I just can't find nothing else in Scripture. It's in Scripture, and I preach it to help you. I don't preach it to make you feel bad. I'm going to stand before God one day and give an account. You're going to stand before, and when you're standing before God, I don't want you looking over me wherever I'm at in the line and saying, man, I wish the preacher would have told me I ought to have been faithful to church. Don't get mad at a preacher when he preaches that you ought to be in church every time the doors are open. If it's in the book, he's right. Which means anybody that disagrees is wrong. And I don't say that to hurt you. I'm trying to do what I'm about to commission and charge Brother Caleb to do. Modesty. Other gods. What's your lowercase g god? We're quick to jump on athletics, aren't we? Because we're all out of shape and out of the day of playing. And so we throw off on anybody, bless God, they miss church to go to a ball game. And you know your pastor. I'm there on that one. We don't miss church to go to a ball game. It becomes a god in our life when we do. But don't throw the stones at the athletic families and you go do your hobby and your thing and prioritize what you want to do over church and think it's okay. It's the same little god. It just looks different and shaped different. We preach on these truths because the Bible now commissions you to rebuke, to reprove. It's part of the calling that God has placed on this young man's life. The preacher and his mandate, and then let's finish up with the preacher and his message. The preach is the first imperative because it is the most important imperative. The other commands that we're about to go through rapidly all hinge on that first command to preach the word. You with me on that? That's why it was first. Now Paul uses the words reprove, rebuke, and exhort. And isn't it something that he is already letting us know how resistant people would be to the true preaching of the word of God? Already by his verbiage, he's letting us know they're not all going to like this, Timothy. They're not all going to receive this, Timothy. You're going to have to be willing. So he uses, first of all, the word reprove. I'm going to give you three C words to go with each of these words as we go through this. Reprove means to bring conviction. Conviction is your word. To point out errors, to expose the error of one's way. So Paul is charging Timothy, Timothy, you preach, and you preach in a way that brings conviction. This is the mind that a preacher is to have. One that corrects the errors of men's beliefs. One that corrects the errors of men's practices. And I would say genuine biblical preaching exposes evil and brings conviction on the sinner. If you're never convicted by the word of God, the preaching is not biblical, or your heart is not where you think it is. Your preaching is going to bring conviction. The power of the Holy Ghost. He says rebuke. Now I know the smiles are about gone at this point, and these are not words that we like, but you are agreeing, church body, that is what this man is called to do as he's being ordained into the ministry. Don't fuss at him if in this chapter of his life, if he comes at you and says, Dad, Mom, I'm really concerned that Junior is. Don't fuss at him if he biblically tries to reprove and rebuke in a loving way. Don't get mad at him. Don't push away from him. He's not only loving on you as a true friend would, he's fulfilling the call of God in his life. To rebuke, all right, so reprove, conviction. Rebuke, correction. Conviction, correction. Goes a little deeper on this one. He says, you correct the error. All right, you've already preached, and the Holy Spirit of God through your preaching has brought conviction. Now there's an element of correcting the error, of reprimanding somebody who is in sin and out of step and the will of God. You say, whoa, a preacher's supposed to do that? I'd submit to you, be thankful for every man of God in your life that's been willing to be a biblical man of God and messenger of the gospel of Jesus Christ that cares for you enough and loves you enough to say, hey, you ought not to be doing this. Hey, you know this is wrong in your life. Hey, you know this is not pleasing to the Lord. Hey, you know you ought to be doing such and such. Don't get mad. Don't leave the church. Don't write him off. Thank God for a man who would love you enough to help you as you prepare to stand on Judgment Day. To correct, to reprimand. Preaching must warn the sinner of the dangers of sin. So it's to be with conviction and bring conviction. It's to bring correction. Well, bless God, it ain't none of his business to correct. Oh, actually, according to the Bible, it is his business. And if I had time, I'd take you to Hebrews, where it makes it very clear of a flock and an under-shepherd's relationship. And listen, you look at this old boy, it has nothing to do with this sorry old rascal that you're looking at. But it has everything to do with the authority that the great shepherd has put on the under-shepherd. And I recommit myself to diligently, compassionately love you enough to continue to tell you what you need to hear, to bring correction when it's needed. But then thirdly, what would be the third exhortation under preach, really the fourth that we have here, is to exhort. You reprove, you rebuke, you exhort. You bring conviction through the power of the Holy Ghost. You bring correction. But with exhorting, you bring comfort. Never do you get up and preach on sin as hard as you may do it with a finger pointed out, realizing you don't have three pointing back at you. And you walk in a way understanding we are no better. We are wretched sinners saved by grace. And the same grace that I've needed in my life from a God above is the same grace that sometimes people you're ministering to needs. Oh, we may have to preach hard sometimes, but it's not with a hammer just wanting to knock somebody out. The word comfort is paraclete. You know, it's the coming alongside of. Well, if I encourage you in a way and you're like, well, what does he think his business to tell me I should be here, I should be doing all I'm trying to do? Is lovingly come alongside of you. Reprove, rebuke, exhort. And then he says, you exhort, you comfort, you walk alongside of, get this, with all long suffering. Go ahead and tell you, it's hard. Sometimes it's frustrating. Sometimes it makes you beat both sides of your brain and think, what is going on in the mind? How is someone so defiant to what God makes so clear? But he says you do it with long suffering, patience, endurance. It's the word picture of a long fuse. We all feel like we could at times, right? That fuse on a minister of the gospel has just got to keep looping. Or else you'd blow up so many times. It's a picture of a long fuse. It's not our goal to become frustrated or exasperated with the people of God when they do not respond. Can I bring your attention back to 3 and 4? I almost felt like, and we would never do this to the Word of God, but verse 3 says, for the time will come. I almost felt like we could read, for the time is here. Are you still with me in verse 3? Are we here? For they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. Brother, be patient. Be long-suffering. You'll need it for both ends of the spectrum. You'll need it for the new believer. You'll need it for the teenager, you'll need it for the one you haven't seen in a few weeks and you want to reach out to and love. But you'll need it for the saint that's been saved for 50 years. And you lay down your head and think, I sure never thought he would do that. I sure never thought she would exhibit that spirit. There'll be people saved longer than you're alive. But you have to exhibit long-suffering. You have to give grace. Makes you scratch your head sometimes. Man, you think they'd have it figured out by now. Why do they? But oh, our humanity reminds us all. The wicked sinners we are. Keep reproving. Keep rebuking. Keep exhorting. Even when they don't respond to the word of God as they should. Remember, that's between them and the Almighty God, our Creator. And then we close by looking at, he says, you exhort with long suffering. The first sub, the second sub is with doctrine. Exhort with doctrine. Everything rises and falls here. We'll talk about it in a minute, but he's already committed and recommitted and will publicly commit today to the core doctrines of our faith, the Bible teaches. And so Paul comes back to this here because he says, as you preach the word, you instruct the people on the doctrines of the Bible. Your opinions, your beliefs, your thoughts are irrelevant. I was talking to a man just this week. I was asking about church. The Lord brought him my path. I said, boy, I don't want to miss this opportunity. And I began talking to him. And David, he said, I've looked at Scripture and as I've read it, he said, I've just had to come to the point, and I'm paraphrasing his idea, but I have had to come to the point of, what does that mean to me? Now, could he have said that innocently? Maybe. But can I be real direct to you as we close? It don't matter what you think it says. It doesn't matter what you think it means to you. Because it don't mean something to you and means something else to somebody else. You ready? It means what it means. And that is why a pastor's job is to feed the flock, not tell you, well, I read this verse and I think, what does the Bible say? But Brother Wayne, that's all that matters. You're to give instruction. Thus saith the Lord. What you are called and now will be charged to do must never be compromised. Now, doesn't being a preacher sound so fun? Isn't it so glamorous? No. It's humbling. It's convicting. And it's a challenge that we realize outside of the help of Almighty God, there is no way I can be and do what God wants me to. Let's bow in prayer, please. If I could have a musician come. Lord, we thank you for your help and your love, and I just want to be obedient to your spirit. I have prepped our people that we are going to a brief time of charging our dear brother, but yet, Lord, your word has been preached. And I believe anytime it's preached with conviction, it brings conviction. The Holy Spirit does. And Lord, there may be hearts right now struggling. There may be hearts resistant. There may be some pride that has swelled up because as I charge a young man to preach, I've tried to do what I was charged to do and what you've called me to do. And that means there's some reproving and there's some rebuking. And Lord, it may be something that you have put your finger on in the hearts of our dear people this morning that they need to come right now. They don't need to use an excuse of what's to follow. They don't need to let anything keep them from dealing with what your spirit has spoken to them about. So I pray, Lord, right now in a moment, when we stand, they won't waste any time. They'll walk to this altar. They'll confess if there's something they need to confess. They'll get something right if there's something they need to get right. Maybe it's their spirit. Maybe as they've sat here today, they've begun to boil and brew a little bit, Lord, because of the stiffness of a message. But God, there is no way we can take the calling and the charge you place upon us in a joking, non-serious way. Help us to be obedient. And may there not be one person walk out of this service, Lord, that has disobeyed your spirit today. In your son's name we pray. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Let's all stand our feet. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm not going to ask for a raising of hands. The Spirit of God has spoken to you. He's already spoken to you. You feel it right now. But I'm going to ask you to slip out right now. Slip out right now. Maybe the Spirit of God has put His finger on something specific in your life. Maybe you've been mad at someone for telling you the truth. Maybe you have prioritized something else over the things of God. Listen, I don't know what it is, and I can't play the Holy Spirit. But I know He's working. And we're not going to tarry long, but we're going to conclude this in a very special way for Brother Caleb. But this is your verse. The Holy Spirit is speaking. Don't leave here in defiance and disobedience to what the Holy Spirit of God is doing in your heart this morning. God, help us. If we make this transition, we'll invite you to be seated quickly. We'll invite our kids to come in. We'll invite Brother Caleb and Miss Hannah now to move to this front row together, if you will. And our church kids, they're in the lobby. They're going to come on in with their teachers now. And we've tried to save a little bit of time. And we'll try to keep this right around 10 minutes, as we've already given him the thrust of his charge, but not the complete charge. So kids, you come on in quietly and find a place with your parents, if you will. And thank you, Miss Lindsay. And we have Brother Caleb and Miss Hannah up front, of course, ordaining Brother Caleb into the gospel ministry, realizing God has given him a helpmeet and his wife to be beside him, to encourage him, to help them along the way. And but only one of you is receiving ordination today, all right? And that's going to be the one that God has called and directed to do that, all right? We've gathered ourselves together in this solemn and most holy occasion. We've met here today to set aside a special young man, to ordain him into the gospel ministry. We're publicly acknowledging our own confidence in Brother Caleb, in his calling into the ministry, and in his ability to carry out the ministry that God has placed upon him through the power of the Holy Spirit. I say to you, it is an honor to be asked to be involved in this service and to officiate the ordination of you into the gospel ministry of Jesus Christ. In our text, Paul had already laid hands on young Timothy and commissioned him, commanded him as a general would to a battle field officer on the battlefield. He used such terminology to help Timothy understand that it required his undivided attention to the matter that was at hand. The Bible said, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Another verse of scripture, we'll give several verses today, and we'll try to do that in a timely manner, but it's the verse you've chosen for your youth department. Let no man despise thy youth. Be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, and in purity. One more scripture I'll give you at this point that we'll come back to, just reminding us the Bible says all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Brother Caleb, age of 12 years old, we'll go over this in just a moment, but he has filled out a questionnaire, very detailed, 7-8 pages of questioning on the doctrines and the call of God's life. And it was at junior camp, he was a 12-year-old boy, that he felt the call of God on his life into the preaching ministry. But it was not till 15 years of age that he nailed that down, and the Spirit of God pinned him and put him in a place where he knew it was the hand of God on his life to not just serve the Lord, but to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, in a very brief explanation of his calling, we understand what the Lord told Jeremiah the prophet, that I formed you in the womb. I knew before you ever were here what I had for you. And God has certainly done that for our dear brother. So you as a church know, as an ordaining body, again, he has filled out his complete examination of doctrinal questions, biblical questions, his commitment to the doctrines, to the King James Bible, to the call on his life, even agreeing at any time if he was to forfeit and to violate his call on his life, that he would return the credentials he's receiving to this local body that is commissioning or ordaining him, And so all of that is right here, and I just bring that up because I want you to know this is not something that we take lightly or have taken lightly. We reviewed these answers carefully with him, and certainly thankful for the information that he's provided for us in that. So, Brother Caleb, I charge you to give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy, the laying on the hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. And before we continue on with the charge, I am going to ask you just at this time by yourself to stand and take two steps forward. He has been questioned on these things. He has committed to them. He has reviewed that with me and recommitted himself verbally face to face. But you being a part of the ordination, I have a few questions I'm going to ask him publicly to confirm with the nodding of his head and a verbal confirmation. So as you as a church are witnesses of these things. Brother Caleb, do you confirm before this body your God-given call to preach? You secondly confirm and commit to preach the word of God without partiality. Do you confirm and your commitment to the King James Bible as the inspired, preserved word of God for the English-speaking people, and commit to use the King James in all ministry interactions? Do you confirm and commit to the core doctrines of our faith? Do you confirm and commit publicly to the Free Will Baptist distinctives? Do you confirm and commit publicly to a lifelong student of this precious book that we hold in our hands and that we will soon present to you and are told within its pages to study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman? Do you commit to this as a lifelong commitment? I'm going to turn into the Bible that we will be presenting here, him here with in just a minute, to a passage of Scripture that I want to read from 1 Timothy chapter 3 before I ask him this next question. This is a true saying, if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach. Not given to wine, no striker, not greedy, of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous. One that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall in a reproach and the snare of the devil. To the best of your ability and knowledge, do you meet the qualifications that 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 7 require for a minister of the gospel? Do you confirm and commit publicly to be guided and empowered by the Holy Spirit of God? Do you accept the solemn responsibilities that are placed upon you this day in ordaining you into the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Church, you have both seen and heard his answers, and so I ask you as a church body now, do you first of all accept the ordination of Brother Caleb Griffey into the gospel ministry? Second of all, do you commit to support, love, and pray for Brother Caleb? Amen. Thank you for your help with that. If you'll briefly return to sit beside your wife. Brother Caleb, as a minister, you must never forget you've been called of God to preach. You're called to the highest and most noble calling in all of the world. You are set apart by God for the specific work of preaching the gospel. It is a calling that is to be carried out in a professional manner. At all times, realizing you are representing the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It is not only affected in the professional line, but in your personal life, you should represent the things of God in your daily walk and conduct from day to day. You're to strive to be spirit-controlled, and you're to aim to live a disciplined life, understanding that the disciplines of a godly man are growing, forming in the sanctification process. Sixthly, you are to understand you are entering a divine calling. This pastor can't call you. This church body can't call you. Your faithful parents can't call you. It is a divine calling. To preach, thus saith the Lord, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not essays, not moral subjects, not lectures of any kind or academia subjects, not theories, but simply, boldly, compassionately, with conviction, preach the Word of God. I challenge you to remember that God has set you as a watchman upon the wall. If you are unfaithful and do not warn the sinner with all of your energy, God will hold you accountable. I lastly remind you, Brother Caleb, of the sorrows and the joys of your calling. Yes, there will be sorrows. There will be difficulties. There will be difficult seasons. But oh, please, my brother, please understand, there will always be joy. Stay faithful. Stay committed to the one who has called you. Above all else, serve him with everything that's within you, striving to please the one that you will stand before one day. The latter part of the challenge from our message comes after we understand that some will turn away and give their ears to the truth and shall be turned into fables. And then this is the conclusion of your charge. It says, but in spite of that happening, watch thou in all things. You do have a keen alertness about you. And sometimes I think in my own life, and I've shared this with you, wow, why do I always see? You're to be alert, keenly aware of what is going on. Next, in verse 5, it says you're to endure afflictions. You and your wife must understand it's not always going to be easy. It's not always going to be the cool whip on top. But you're to endure, persevere, keep going, stay faithful. As in your personal life, you're to do the work of an evangelist, always striving. Although you may not be called to travel the country, always striving to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with someone. Doing the work of an evangelist, making full proof of thy ministry that God has called you to. So in understanding this, we pray with you and for you that the Lord would bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious upon you. Lord, lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. May the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing to his sight through Jesus Christ. To him be glory forever. Ever. As we present this new Bible to Brother Caleb here in a moment, he already knows this. The nicest thing about this Bible is not the goat skin that it's wrapped in, although that is nice and should protect this Bible for a very long time. But it's the scripture found within. Scripture such as Hebrews 4:12. And 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, which we've already read. Matthew 24 and 35 and Isaiah 48, helping us to realize the Word of God is eternal and will never be cast away. The Word of God, church, will always, always stand. And as a minister of the gospel, he understands this. So if you'll step forward, Caleb, it is our honor to not only be a part of this service, but to present to you the Bible that he has selected, that he desires to preach from in the future days as God keeps his hand upon your life. We challenge you, stay true to this book. Never veer to the left or to the right. Preach the truth. Preach the word, and remember, be instant in season, out of season. Faithful to the word of God. It is with that charge we present you this copy of the Word of God, blessing you and praying for you. And this time I'm going to ask him with his Bible to kneel right here in front of the pulpit. I'm going to ask all of our ordained ministers and ordained men, even though you may not actively be serving as an ordained deacon or minister, you have an ordination on your life. I'm going to ask you to come at this time, men. Quickly, would you please? And let's lay hands on this, our brother. This is a biblical principle and step that we take. I referred twice to Paul already before chapter 4, laying his hands on young Timothy. Guys, you come around. If you need to get up on the steps, that is fine. We lay our hands on this dear brother, commissioning him, charging him, ordaining him in the gospel ministry that God has called him to. Church, where you're at, would you join us in this prayer? And I'm going to ask our other ordained minister in this service, Dad, if you'll lead us in this prayer of laying on hands. ask our musicians to just softly play, Find and Play, Take My Life, just softly. I'm going to ask Miss Hannah, Brother Caleb, if you'll stay here. I'm going to ask Miss Hannah to join Brother Caleb here in the front of the steps facing the congregation. So thank you, congregation, for your patience and understanding of this special time. So based on what we have done as a church, what he has publicly recommitted himself to for this body, upon your receiving that and praying to support, love, and pray for him, we now present this certificate of ordination. This is to certify that Caleb Griffey has been set apart, called to the ministry of the gospel on the 20th day of August in the year of 2023 at Wildwood Free Baptist Church. Pastor Jonathan Ainge and the body of Wildwood Free Baptist Church. All in favor, let it be known by saying aye. Brother, God bless you. We present you with this. Support you to the high calling that God has called him to. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand. Let's extend the right hand of congratulations to him as you're dismissed. If you'll just come through, shake his hand. Let him know, not that you just are proud of him, but you'll be praying for him. All right, Miss Lindsay's going to keep playing a song that's a good reminder for all of us. Take my life. Let it be, Lord, consecrated to thee. Would you come this way right behind Ronnie and Phil? Shake this, our brother's hand. You're dismissed. Don't forget, Revive Conference tonight. Brother Henry Horn, be back in service. God bless you, brother. Amen. The Griffeys, would y'all please come forward as well? And brother, if you and your wife will stand right here to the right of Miss Hannah.